going to Genoa.
Joining us on the show today is Puru Saxena. He's previously the founder of an investment firm located in Hong Kong, a longtime guest and contributor to Financial Sense. Now he's a full-time investor, actively followed by investors all around the world. You can follow his work and his thoughts and a number of the different companies and picks that he is invested in on Twitter at Saxena_Puru. We'll also have a link to his Twitter profile where this interview is located on Financial. Your take, where do you see things at today?
Well, Chris, I got a few things right, but I also got a couple of things wrong. And to be fair, I think your listeners should also know about those. I was pretty bearish about the indices in late 2022 and coming into early 2023, simply because I felt that the market hadn't fully discounted the recession risk. That was obviously the wrong thing to do. I was wrong about that. The recession hasn't hit yet because of the excess helicopter money, which was provided by the governments during the COVID pandemic. And I think there is still a risk of a recession. But as you know, the economy is not the stock market and the stock market is not the economy. You know, plenty of times when the economy is weak, stocks go up and vice versa. And I was wrong about the, you know, continuing bear market at the index level. But you're right, I have been scaling in into the growth stocks for a while now. And I think that they've bottomed out. And I also feel that the indices have bottomed out as well now, Chris. I think unless we have some financial Armageddon, I would be very surprised to see the S&P go down to even anywhere near its last October's lows. And this cycle was very peculiar, Chris, because if you see over the last sort of 15 years or so, if you look back, you will realize that the stock market usually peaked after the end of the QE or towards the end of the QE. And then the market basically bottomed at the start of the QE, the new round of QE. This is what happened between 2007, 2008, up until 2020 during the COVID pandemic. However, this cycle was very strange in the sense that the stock market became smarter and it started discounting tighter monetary conditions several months before the end of QE. I mean, QE ended in spring 2022, but growth stocks peaked in summer and autumn 2021. The NASDAQ peaked in November 21, and also the S&P peaked at the beginning of January in 2023. So the stock market basically whiffed out the tighter monetary conditions, even though the Fed was still buying bonds and doing QE, and interest rates were still at record lows. So the top of the market basically fooled a lot of people because people were expecting the market to make new highs with QE still going on. But the market basically discounted all of that several months before the end of QE. And I feel that the reverse also took place late last year when basically the stock market seemed to have discounted the worst in October, November, December period last year. That also basically coincided with a trough in global liquidity. And the stock market basically started looking ahead and it discounted, or it seems to have discounted, whatever problems we are likely to see ahead. So the market, in my view, has become better as a discounting mechanism. It is basically looking further ahead, further out, and basically anticipating changes in monetary policy and corporate earnings way before than it used to.
And so you said, you know, the October bottom that we saw last year, you don't think we're going to be revisiting those lows. So it sounds like you're basically on a bullish track now. You believe that the primary trend for the market is generally going to be higher from here.
That is correct. I mean, if you look at the, and opinions in this business, Chris, are a dime or a dozen. You know, people get things wrong, myself included. But if you look at the price action, and if you look at what people are actually doing, or the majority of the people are doing with their money, prices have been trending higher for several months now. And if you see the bear market structure, during the bear market, prices were basically trending lower for most of the stocks. The indices were also declining, trending lower. The 40-week moving average, which is the 200 moving average, was sloping downwards and trending lower. And now, if you look at the indices, the S&P, the NASDAQ, you look at the growth stocks, you look at the IWO, which is the Russell 2000 growth, you look at the Russell 2000 IWM, all of these indices are now basically above the 40-week moving average. And in all cases, the 40-week moving average is now sloping upwards. So unless we get a horrendous recession in the near future, which appears unlikely at this point, I would be very surprised if the indices basically have a huge setback. I think there will be consolidations along the way, but at least on an index level, and especially for the growth stocks, which are still smashed considering where they were, you know, 2 years ago, I think the path of least resistance is up.
Okay. Now, in the short term, there's been a lot of talk about, you know, the Magnificent Seven. So that'd be Apple, Microsoft, and the like, NVIDIA throw in there, of course. But, you know, the high amount of concentration and outperformance that we've seen in these stocks since the October low, you know, they've moved so fast so far. I mean, if you look at the first half of this year, the NASDAQ alone was up over 30%. I mean, that's phenomenal. Just for the first 6 months, we just spoke with Jeffrey Hirsch at Stock Traders Almanac, and he says, you know, we should expect at least some digestion and consolidation over the next few months. Would you agree with that? Maybe short-term consolidation or digestion, slight correction possibility, but within the context of, like you said as well, that the general trend expected to be higher at this point?
Well, Chris, we've had a huge run-up, as you've just alluded to, especially in these AI-related names, the mega caps. I mean, this rally was also unusual in the sense that normally when you come off a bear market bottom, the speculative stuff jumps the most. The small caps, the unprofitable companies, the stuff which has been more smashed rallies the most. But in this cycle, funnily, because of the AI angle, money basically flocked towards the large liquid mega cap leaders, which were directly going to be beneficiaries of the AI boom. So we've had this huge run-up now in the likes of NVIDIA. I think NVIDIA is extremely overbought. The chart has just gone vertical and it's up like 400% or something since October last year. Microsoft is flirting with its all-time highs. If you look at the XLK, which is the tech ETF, Spider, basically, that's also flirting with its all-time high. And a number of these mega caps have just gone vertical, which is always worrisome because normally when you have such parabolic moves, they are always followed by at least a pullback or some sort of consolidation. So I would agree that the large cap liquid leaders, the mega caps, are due for some sort of a breather over the next few weeks as we enter the seasonally weak period for the stock market. But also, if you look under the surface, you will realize that the rally appears to be broadening out. So, you know, if you look at the IWO, you look at the IWM, you look at the World Cloud ETF, Cloud Computing ETF, you look at the growth stocks in general, they've all built a multi-month stage one basis, which is when prices zigzag for several months and oscillate around the 40-week moving average. And now they are basically beginning to break out into stage two breakouts, which is when stocks register the bulk of their gains. So if you look at the price action, and if you look at the price structure and the charts of all these companies in the high growth space, they are basically breaking out as of now, out of like 12 to 15 month long sideways trading ranges. And that usually suggests that, you know, there's going to be more gains in the weeks and months ahead. So I think although the big cap leaders may actually take a breather and have some sort of digestion or consolidation, I think if the Fed signals later this week that they are going to basically pause and they are done for this cycle, I think there is going to be a monster rally in the long duration growth stocks because they were the ones which were the most badly hurt given this record severe monetary tightening which took place. So if the Fed says, right, we are done for now, I think there's going to be a huge rally in the long duration stuff.
So like you said, the bull market rally, it's broadening out. It appears that there is a pretty significant rotation happening. And like you said, we're seeing some pretty significant breakouts in other areas of the market and sectors, whether or not that is the industrial and materials sector, which are more cyclically sensitive. So again, from your vantage point, these are all positive signs for a bull market that has some legs.
I would agree. I think this is the case. But, you know, in this business, as you know, nothing is set in stone. Things change quickly. If the Fed overshoots and basically keeps hiking and it breaks the economy, then obviously you will get a more, or you're likely to get a more meaningful pullback in asset prices. But if you look at, you know, the carnage in this recently concluded bear market, Chris, some of the software names, the e-commerce names, the payments and fintech names, anything which was long duration, which was badly hit by this you know, abrupt rise in interest rates, was smashed. This was not a garden variety bear market, this was a humongous bust on par with the 1929-1932 crash. Although the indices did not go down 80-90% during this bear market, and most of the growth stocks fell 70-80-90% during this 2-year period or 18-month period. So, you know, we've had a colossal bust now in the recent sort of past. We've had a period of base building. Now, these stocks are basically unloved, out of favor. Most people don't want to touch them with a barge pole. I mean, if you look at the sentiment towards these companies on Twitter, where I run this account and post my thoughts on the various companies and so forth that I'm investing in, most people on Twitter now basically regard these high growth, younger growth companies in the e-commerce, payments, and software space as shitcos. You know, they think, oh, this is some bubble which has imploded. People basically were very, very bullish about these companies in mid to late 2021, when I was basically, you know, warning that this bubble was going to pop. A lot of people were saying, well, you don't know what you're talking about. You know, you are not in your 20s anymore. You're just an old fogey, you know, all that sort of stuff. And now, you know, for the last 6 to 9 months, when I've been, you know, scaling into these names and suggesting that perhaps this is the time to buy, most people don't want to own these names. And this is what usually happens. You know, price determines sentiment. And when prices are rallying and everybody's happy and making money, then everybody thinks these companies are wonderful. When they've had huge busts and their valuations are low and they're hated, which is when you should be buying them, nobody wants to touch them because everybody has a recency bias. They look at, you know, the performance over the last 12 to 18 months and they think, oh, just because something's gone down 70-80%, this is a terrible investment. And in investing, that is usually a contrary signal. When things are down in the dumps, when prices are low and valuations are compressed and sentiment is dire, that is usually when you make your big money. You know, when you chase things which are highly popular, when they've risen 300-400%, and you're nearing the end of the cycle, that's when you basically lose 50-60% of your money pretty quickly. So I would argue, if you have a longer term mindset, if you're investing for the next 3 to 5 years, not short term consolidations and pullbacks notwithstanding, I think these payments, e-commerce and software businesses are likely to deliver some pretty decent returns over this period.
Okay, so we talked about AI-related stocks earlier, and when most people think about the companies that are invested around that, that's the mega cap tech stocks, right? I mean, so Google, Microsoft, OpenAI, but obviously you'd have to play them through Microsoft since Microsoft had purchased the access to their models. So again, Meta, Microsoft, Google, NVIDIA, these are all the names that commonly come up when you're talking about AI. You said that you think these stocks, NVIDIA in particular, have run up really, really far and extremely overbought. So are you invested or have any exposure around the AI space, this AI theme, which is very strong still? And if so, how?
Well, Chris, I didn't invest in NVIDIA, which is my mistake. I should have, you know, jumped into NVIDIA late last year, but I didn't. So I missed that one, but I have a large exposure to a number of software companies, cloud computing companies, which are also basically, you know, now entering the AI space one way or another. And I think there are many ways to skin the cat. You know, the NVIDIA was the obvious picks and shovels play. There is going to also be an application layer, which is where some companies are going to make a fortune, you know, like OpenAI or some other businesses which come out with some good tools where, you know, consumers interact with, use AI on a daily basis. That's when they're going to make some big winners. But that's a pretty difficult, endeavor to try and pick which the winners will be so early in this race. On the flip side, I believe that AI is going to have a profound impact on the way business is done all around the world. And there will be some big AI winners, but I also feel that there are going to be some very big AI losers, companies and industries which are totally disrupted by artificial intelligence. So investors will have to be very careful of what they're actually investing in. And just because a company has done well in the past may not be the reason to hold the business, because the company may be totally disrupted by artificial intelligence. So you have to be careful. I mean, personally, I'm investing in the younger growth companies. I don't really invest in the mega caps because they're already, you know, past their prime in terms of the growth rates. The growth rates for the revenues for these businesses have come down. to sort of, you know, 10, 15, 17%. All the companies that I have invested in personally, they're all growing north of sort of 30% year over year on a revenue basis. And they have very long runways and they are smaller companies. Therefore, in my opinion, they offer a much higher, you know, potential for gains over the next few years. I think investors in the Big Seven or the Magnificent Seven, as they are called these days, will also do well over the next several years. But I think better returns might be achievable by investing in these younger growth companies. So just to give you an example, you know, I own shares of Adyen, which is a Dutch payments processor, in basically which deals with all the big merchants. Their business is growing at about 30% year over year. They're profitable, free cash flow positive, a very high return on equity, and they've got a very long runway. I own shares of Datadog, CrowdStrike, GitLab, Confluent, Snowflake in the software space. In e-commerce, I own shares of Global-E. I own shares of Tesla, which in my opinion is going to probably become the biggest business in the world within the next 10 years. So I own some of these faster growing younger companies business-wise, which I feel offer better growth potential over the next few years. And, you know, a lot of people seem to have forgotten, Chris, that these software businesses have recurring revenues. You know, when customers sign up for cybersecurity or observability or data lakes or data mining and so forth, or data analytics, these businesses, they don't just buy software like they used to on a license basis. You know, now they basically pay these vendors a subscription, either you know, a usage-based model, or they pay per user, per seat on a monthly, quarterly, or annual basis. So, you know, the revenues and cash flows for these businesses are very, very sticky. So even if there is a recession or an economic deterioration, the growth rates of these companies may slow down as new customers don't sign up. But the existing businesses are not going anywhere. You know, you try and running your business or try running Financial Sense website without cybersecurity, and I like to see how long you last. You simply cannot function without the software, which is now essential. So I've got a very large position in software businesses. At the moment, these companies, a lot of them are not profitable on a GAAP basis simply because they're spending as much money as they can on sales and marketing to try and attract as many customers as they can, because they know that the lifetime value of these customers is a lot higher than the cost of acquisition, which makes perfect sense. So they are spending money hand over fist to try and get as many people hooked to their software so then they can start, you know, generating recurring revenues and cash flows. But a lot of these businesses that I just mentioned are already free cash flow positive. They have very high free cash flow margins. They are also positive on a non-GAAP operating basis. So I think these companies are pretty promising for the next 4 to 5 years.
You still think that there's a pretty bright future for Tesla?
I do. I think that this business is likely to become the biggest business on the planet within the next 10 years. And I don't say that lightly, because if you look at the industries that they are tackling, Chris, the industries that they're going after, you know, they're going after the EV space, which is a huge market. And then they've got, you know, an iron in the fire in the energy, you know, space, the energy business. Then they're basically getting into the autonomous driving, the FSD, which is going to be a very high margin, sticky business for Tesla. And if that basically comes off, which I think it will, it is a question of time. I believe this is going to be a real game changer for Tesla, simply because, you know, they are going to generate recurring revenues, which are going to be very high margin. And Elon Musk mentioned during the recent earnings call that Tesla is in discussions with a major OEM to license their FSD technology. So if Tesla becomes one of the major operating systems for, you know, autonomous driving all over the world, you can only imagine what that is going to do to the margins. I mean, just for an example, you know, when the PC boom took off, or the computing boom took off 20, 30 years ago, a lot of companies made the computer hardware, but Microsoft was the operating system. And we all know how that worked out for Microsoft and for the other hardware players. So I think the autonomous is the key for Tesla. If they pull it off, which I think they will, then that's really going to be a game changer and add significant value to Tesla, for Tesla as a business and for the shareholders. And on top of that, you also have, you know, potential for advertising on Tesla. I know that seems far-fetched today, but, you know, if you have a massive screen in your car, there is no, you know, stopping Tesla basically generating a lot of advertising revenue by promoting other companies and other services on their platform, which is also going to be a high margin business for Tesla. And Elon Musk has also recently, you know, mentioned that the Optimus, which is the humanoid robot, that is going to probably end up being a much bigger business than the EV business. And that also, I think, will have significant use cases if they pull it off, which I think they will, given how strong they are in technology. I think Optimus has also got the potential of being a real game changer for Tesla, simply because, you know, you'll see a lot of this manual work in factories and manufacturing, logistics and so forth, which now takes place, you know, by humans. Basically, people do that work. That is basically very, you know, low paying, boring work. And then companies also have to deal with human beings, which basically come with their own set of problems, you know, sick leave, unions, annual holidays and all that kind of stuff, you know, firing people, hiring people and all of that. So if the Optimus robot can basically, you know, do all of this without the fuss of what humans bring to the table, then I think it's a no-brainer that a lot of the companies are going to basically deploy the robots as opposed to humans to basically do all the, you know, blue-collar jobs in the factories and so forth. So I think the potential for this is quite massive. And also later on, you know, there's no saying that, you know, people and households wouldn't want to own these things either, because, you know, if the robot can basically clean your apartment or your home, and clean the windows, you know, do the vacuuming, mopping and all that kind of stuff, do the dishes for you, you know, who wouldn't want to own one? So I think the possibilities are pretty exciting for the business. I think there is a real possibility that this could be a $3 to $4-5 trillion market cap business within the next 10 years.
Yeah, we do have a robotic vacuum that shuttles around and vacuums our carpets. But I'm just imagining, you know, in a few years, maybe 5 to 10 years from now, having an actual humanoid robot going around and vacuuming and doing various cleaning tasks. I mean, that's sci-fi territory right there.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much everything Elon Musk has done so far is sci-fi territory. I mean, who would have imagined 10, 15 years ago that, you know, Tesla is going to become the best-selling car, the Model Y, this year globally? I mean, nobody would have thought that possible. Nobody thought that, you know, he would basically bring back rockets and land them, you know, without and make rockets reusable. Nobody thought that possible. So, you know, he's a very, very intelligent man, very driven, and he's got his own skin in the game. You know, he's basically obviously not doing it for money at this point. He's got more money than anybody needs for the next 100 lifetimes. He's clearly driven and, you know, very focused, and I wouldn't bet against Elon Musk.
Well, Puru, as we close, again, you see the bull market broadening out. It does appear, as we discussed, you know, that investors are trimming back, taking profits in some of these big cap, mega cap names. And we're starting to see some life come into smaller cap sectors and these high growth names that you are primarily invested in. You do like the underlying theme with regards to artificial intelligence and think that Tesla and some of these other application layer companies will benefit from that long term. But again, perhaps less focus on the mega cap names, which could be disrupted moving forward. Focus on the areas that see more growth potential. And you gave a bunch of companies out, and you obviously list these and give regular updates on your Twitter profile. So do want to encourage again all of you that are interested in following more of these companies and what Puru is doing in this space to follow him at Saxena_Puru. Any closing thoughts as we wrap up today's interview?
Well, Chris, I think 100 years of history has shown that stocks basically are the best performing asset class by a country mile. If you look at, you know, the chart which was first published in the book Stocks for the Long Run by Jeremy Siegel, that basically was an eye-popping chart which showed, you know, how a dollar invested in the stock market 200 years ago is worth several million, you know, versus other asset classes which have not kept up at all. And the difference, the disparity between equities and other asset classes is just mind-boggling if you look at that chart. So I would just, you know, urge your listeners to not get too wound up and caught up in the negativity. You know, macro things, you know, ebb and flow. The economy booms and then basically goes through a period of correction or a bust. And over the long run, the stock prices of the unbelievable businesses and the good businesses, they always come back up and they always go to new highs. And whoever bets against human ingenuity, you know, capitalism, innovation, they always end up, you know, losing out. They may appear smart in the short run, but they always end up losing and missing out on incredible gains. So, you know, it is all right to be a bit cautious and, you know, pessimistic about the near term, especially when you've had a huge boom and, you know, the monetary conditions are changing and things are likely to deflate. But it never pays to be a long-term bear. And if you are interested in, you know, in making money for yourself and maintaining your purchasing power and protecting your capital from the ravages of inflation, the monetary inflation, which goes on all over the world, then equities, in my opinion, offer the best protection along with some prime real estate. But that's a topic for another day. But, you know, businesses always do well. The good businesses outperform the indices. They always have done. They always will. And it is not very difficult to identify good businesses. You can, all you have to do is look at the competitive position, and all the operating metrics of all these businesses are available publicly. You know, these companies publish quarterly results where they break down the revenues, their costs, their cash flows, what the management is planning and so forth. So investors, if they devote, you know, even an hour or two a day, or even I would say 60 minutes every day, just reading through what the companies are doing and keeping track of the industry and the competitive forces, can actually do well and outperform the indices. It just requires a bit of, you know, hard work and discipline and a strong stomach. You know, as Peter Lynch wrote in his book a long time ago, in this business, you know, a strong stomach is more important than a strong brain. And I 100% agree with that. So, you know, own the businesses, ignore the short-term noise as far as possible, and stay invested in world-changing companies. And I think the result will be pretty satisfactory.
Oh, great words and great investment thoughts to leave off for today's interview. And as always, Puru, it's a pleasure to speak with you on Financial Sense. We look forward to having you on in the future.
Thank you very much, Chris. It's always very nice to talk to you.
Financial Sense News Hour is for informational and educational purposes only and should not be considered as a solicitation or offer to purchase or sell any securities. The investments, investment strategies, and investment philosophies discussed or presented on the News Hour each involve their own unique risk factors, which are not discussed on the show. Responses to listener inquiries are based on the personal opinions of the Financial Sense staff and do not take into account listener suitability, objectives, or risk tolerance. Financial Sense News Hour and its parent company shall not be liable for any financial losses that result from investing in any companies mentioned in Financial Sense or arising out of the use of any material on the News Hour. Be advised that you invest at your own risk.